Champions they are, no doubt about it. In a spectacular game, the Twins sweep the Tigers 9-5. And now as the team vows to fight to the end, this time the end is a whole different ball game. Good evening. Paul Majors will join us from Detroit in just a moment. Topping tonight's News 11, it's on to the World Series for the Twins. They did it today, capturing the American League pennant.
And the game was nothing short of intense, with emotions flying in every direction along with the hits.
Paul Majors and Tom Ryder are standing by in Detroit.
It had to have been an incredible game to watch from Detroit, you guys.
Oh, it was great being here. There's no doubt about that.
Oh, not a doubt.
Although we should tell the boss we were really working hard the whole
time. That's
right.
That's right. It was cold here, too. We were shivering a good part of the time.
You know that song, you know, We Are the Champions by Queen that you guys just had on, by the way? That song, it really does irritate me. And the reason is I've heard it thousands of times, but it's always been in conjunction with some other team.
Somebody else.
So it has sort of a sweeter lilt to it today since it belongs to the Twins at this given moment.
It did sound kind of nice.
Absolutely. I'll tell you what. Let's take a look at a piece of videotape that you're probably going to see hundreds of times for the rest of your life. And that's the Twins clinching the American League Cellar Championship on the field here at Tiger Stadium. They took on the Tigers, the team with the most wins in baseball, and beat them 4-1. The Twins' celebration silences the critics, many of whom picked the Tigers not only to beat the Twins, but to sweep the Twins. But now it is the Twins, not the Tigers, in the 1987 World Series. The Minnesota Twins versus
either the San Francisco Giants or the St. Louis Cardinals, and it looks like now it could be the Giants.
Yeah. How do you rate the Twins going into the series? Are they the underdogs once again?
I think possibly, really. The word is that they're afraid, not afraid, but concerned about the St. Louis Cardinals' great speed. But they also have to worry about San Francisco's power. So one way or the other, their work is cut out, no doubt about it.
Well, they aren't doing too much worrying right now.
No, it's just a wonderful time. Like 22 years we've waited for this, and it's happening right now. All right, let's take a look at some of the key plays of today's championship game.
In the first inning with no score, Matt Noakes hit a ground ball, looked to be a sure base hit. Greg Gagne, though, a fine play, and throws Noakes out, the Twins serving notice early. In the second inning, no score, Tom Bernanski a double, two runs come in to score, and the Twins led 2-0 off Doyle Alexander. Later in the second inning, Dan Gladden, the base hit, Lombardozzi comes in to score, and it was 3-0. And then it was Kirby Puckett's turn, a base hit, Gladden scores, and it was 4-0 off Eric King. In the fourth inning, the Twins leading 4-1, Detroit came back, Matt Noakes a two-run homer to right field, it was 4-3. In the seventh inning, the Twins leading 4-3, a big run right here, not very exciting, a Randy Bush sacrifice fly to center field, Herbeck tags and scores, that made it 5-3. As the Minnesota Twins go on and win their first American League championship in 22 years, and they are World Series bound.
9-5 here at Tiger Stadium, and it's a little crazy still in the locker room.
Let's go down there. Jeff Passel's down there right now with a guest.
All right, it is still a scene of euphoria here in the locker room. Gary Gaetti, the MVP of the series, just coming through the door here after being in the interview room. And Gary, a little worked up, to be honest with you, because he hasn't been able to take part in this celebration. He says, I can't enjoy myself. Everybody's got him going every which way. We'll try and talk to him sometime here. But after the game, we got these comments.
It feels great, Jeff. It's a fantastic feeling. You can't really explain it. What I'm really happy for are the people back home. Finally waiting, and we finally made it, and hopefully we can keep on going.
All year long, it's been a different hero every day, and today we had a couple more heroes. And
right.
Bly Levin did a good job, hung in there as long as he could, and Baron Gare, we got all them shots later, and then Jeff Ridden closed it out. So it's been a team effort all year, man, and today too.
I have one sort of bad feeling that I may work for about 20 or 30 more years in this business and never be with as good a group of guys as we've got assembled here. They've given everything they've gotten to this state of Minnesota. They played hard. They won 2 out of 3 in a very tough ball club at a tough stadium. And I can't say enough about them. And Tom Kelly and the coaching staff, they've done a terrific job.
Back here in the locker room, Ken Herbeck, I think, had the best line of the whole postgame celebration. He said somebody called Domino's Pizza. Domino's Pizza is owned by the guy that owns the Detroit Tigers. The Twins are enjoying themselves here in the locker room. We hope to talk to Tom Kelly. If we can, we're just going to hang in here for just a moment or so. Here he comes right now, Tom Kelly. And Tom, congratulations on an outstanding series and an outstanding season.
Thank you very much. The guys played great for me. Andy McPhail did a great job getting some players and making my job a lot easier. And things fell in place for us, and now we have a chance to go to a World Series.
The Twins, underdogs in the series, but you fooled the critics. You also got the breaks, and now you're getting a little bit of a shower.
Oh, Lordy, I thought that was done with.
I don't think this is going to be done with for a while. But anyway, you got the breaks at the right time, but things really did fall into place.
Well, I tell you, you make your own breaks. You do some things. You try some things. And you take a chance once in a while. And if things work out, well, you call it a break. But my players made the breaks for the ball club. And we played an aggressive type baseball this season. And things did go our way somewhat. And you got to give a lot of credit to our pitchers and our pitching coach, Dick Such, who was ridiculed a lot over the year, and he did a great job with the pitchers.
You've been with this Twins organization 18 years, something like that, so it really has been a long haul for you, even though you're the youngest manager in baseball.
Well, the Twins have been very good to me, right from Calvin Griffith. Always treated me great. Now Mr. Polad's in charge, and he's done a great job by me, and Andy McPhail's a great man to work for, and I'm real happy for the organization.
Tom, on behalf of the Twins fans, thank you. It's been great, and hopefully we can keep her going, huh?
I hope so. We'll do the best we can.
All right. Tom Kelly, the manager of the Twins, the player's manager. We go back up now to Tom and Paul.
Paul, while watching that, I remember a conversation I had with Kelly in the dead of winter when he was in New Jersey. Didn't look like he was going to get the job, and he told me, it looks like I'm out of it. Boy, oh boy, are we ever glad he got the job.
Yeah, he's in the thick of it now, yeah. Oh. Jeff mentioned the euphoria down in the locker room. There also has to be a lot of euphoria going on in the Twin Cities. Let's go to Alan Costantini right now in St. Paul. Alan?
Well, Paul, I think you just introduced me, but this is Jose's Sports Bar in St. Paul. I hope you can hear me. And it's been like this. It's been like this since the game ended over half an hour ago now. But look in the middle down here. Excuse me one second here. Look down here. Can you see this little one? She just can't take the excitement anymore. Listen, let's talk to somebody here and see what their prediction is. Now, you got Jeff Kennedy here. Jeff from St. Paul. Jeff, what about the series now?
Well,
if we have to play St. Louis, how do you think the series will go?
St. Louis will beat them in five. I guarantee the Twins will take them in five.
What about the Giants?
The Giants will beat them in four straight.
Four straight to the Giants. Well, there you go. Now, look at this. Well, they're gone, and the celebration isn't just going on here in St. Paul. It's going on in Minneapolis, too, and that's where Gail Pawaki is.
Hi, Alan. Yeah, in case... For those of you who think that downtown people in Minneapolis don't have spirit, we've organized our own special treat for you right here on the corner of 6th and 4th, and they'd like to perform for you. Now, if that is enthusiasm, I don't know what is. There are other places in downtown Minneapolis, though, where the celebration has really started. And if this isn't happiness, I don't know what is. These people can hardly contain themselves. This is going on down at Hubert's right now. These people are literally dancing in the aisles at Hubert's, having the time of their life. They've waited a long time for this, and they deserve this celebration. And as you can see, everyone is having a wonderful time. This is great. Well, One thing that's still to come tonight is the celebration down at the Dome. Starting at 9 o'clock, you can get in the door free. And everyone is being discouraged from going to the airport. There's going to be no celebration there, but 9 o'clock at the Dome, people are welcome. Back to you, Kevin and Diana.
I think we may want to go back. Do we want to go back to Detroit right now, Tom and Paul Stanton? Let's go back to Detroit.
We're still standing.
Hey, I would like to throw this in. The gentleman in St. Paul who said the Giants would win in four straight, I beg to differ. The Twins can beat either the Cardinals or the Giants, and I truly believe that. I think with their great defense and their hitting, they can beat anybody. And I would say going into the series, they had better be taken seriously.
They're certainly looking like giant killers at this point. I see some of Detroit's finest right back here behind me right now. So I think it's kind of safe, so I'm going to go ahead.
I'll do this right now.
Go Twins.
Yeah, go Twins. Okay, back to you guys real quick.
It's a used hanky.
Yeah, by the way, Colin, we just want to let you know he did say that the Twins would beat the Giants. We just want to set the record straight on that.
Now Tommy likes him again.
Yeah, there you go.
Heck of a guy.
Okay. Thanks a lot. We'll see you guys a little bit later.
Thank you, gentlemen. All over the Twin Cities, people literally stopped what they were doing to watch the game. For instance, in Bloomington, the workers at Lehman's Body Shop got the bosses okay to take a break and watch the action on TV in the garage. Some even came dressed in Twins paraphernalia. Down at the Dome, television sets were on in every office as Twins employees and Dome workers kept watching the game. The atmosphere was intense as everyone watched with bated breath. And now here's a true Twins believer. Philip Gutterman parked himself in front of the Daytons this morning, equipped with a lawn chair, a cooler, a pop, and a portable TV. Gutterman had no doubts about the Twins making the series.
They want to come down here tomorrow morning and then, you know, be back about 200 to 300 people and stand in line. I figured, you know, if I'm going to stand in line, I'll just come down here and camp out overnight.
Gutterman calls himself the complete Twins fan.
Twins fever has hit fans of all ages. Some seniors at Metro Carver Center in Minneapolis got caught up in the action today. They watched the game on TV and waved their homer hankies at all the appropriate plays. And there's one little guy who watched today's game without missing a pitch. Chris Ascenti, whose mentor is Twins pitcher Bert Blyleven, watched from a hospital bed. Earlier this year, Chris underwent treatment for leukemia, and Blyleven went to bat for him by inviting Chris down to the dugout before the treatment.
And today's exciting game made the television department in a lot of stores around the Twin Cities the place to be. Shoppers in Minnetonka, for instance, couldn't just walk past the televisions. They had to stop and watch the game. Anxious fans stood by the sets as they shopped, catching the plays when they could. Now, this is one thing we should mention. Tickets for the World Series go on sale tomorrow. You can buy them at all Metro Dayton stores starting at 8 a.m. Tickets for the first two games will cost between $20 and $30. Each for a limit of, and there is a limit of four per game.
And I think one other thing we want to mention is going to be a special celebration down at the Metrodome tonight starting at 9 o'clock. Yeah. Please join them. Don't go to the airport. Join the Twins as they go into the Metrodome.
It's all free. The gates open at 9, so just come
big
on
celebration.
Down.
Still a common News 11, a debut day for a new shopping center in the Twin Cities.
And more on the Twins as they stick up against the competition. Our Twins coverage continues. So does our Twins coverage continues. Right now we want to get out to Detroit and Paul and Tom.
I think we're the only people that's still in the stadium up here, but there's still a lot of activity down in the clubhouse.
Somehow I thought it would be a little more glorious as we're in the catacombs here.
They've even shut down Tommy's favorite concession stand here.
What a rotten deal that is, I'll tell you.
Well, let's go down to the locker room. Jeff Passolt's down there.
All righty, another local boy makes good. Tim Laudner, Twin Cities native out of Brooklyn Center, Minnesota. You played your little league ball there and some high school ball, and now you're going to the World Series for the Twins.
Most exciting thing that's ever happened to me in my baseball career. I can't think of enough words to describe what the feeling is.
Everybody talks about the Twins and a different player coming up with a big play. That one you made yesterday with Gary Gaetti was just outstanding.
Well, you know, we'll take the outs however we can get them. You know, we're not greedy. You know, if they want to give us the outs, we'll take them. And it's been like that all series long. And people bearing down every out, every pitch, doing what's expected of them. And it was a total team effort.
Tim Laudner, we're proud of you back in Minnesota, and hopefully we can keep her going through the World Series. And another guy coming our way, Bert Blyleven, the veteran pitcher for the Twins. You were with the Twins there for a while. You came.
Yeah.
Oh, you guys are through. But anyway, what was I talking about? Anyway, congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much. We're very happy, and we're very happy for the fans of Minnesota.
Now, it's been a long time coming for you as far as the Twins. You were here, things were going well, then things didn't go so well. You went away and had some success. You've been in the World Series before with Pittsburgh.
Well, 1970, we lost three straight to Baltimore, so that wasn't a good way to start off.
Oh, jeez.
Oh. Did you get that?
I wish I had my mouth open.
Yeah, you know.
Oh, no! Oh, Bruno! I am marking all this down. I'm jotting it down. You guys are through. All right.
As you can see, these guys are very elated.
No, I thought they were kind of low-key, actually. Congratulations.
Well, thank you very much. I'm happy for all 23 of these other guys. We worked our tail ends off to get to the position we're in right here, and you look cold.
Let's not waste the opportunity. I'm going to go back to you guys and hit the showers or something.
The Champagne Olympics going on.
That's
down
right.
There.
He faced enemy batters in Detroit, and his wife faced a Twinkie threat in the stands, but that was put to rest.
Blyleven, of course, in the series in 1979 when he was with Pittsburgh, so a return trip for him.
That's right, and he pitched for the Twins in the 1970 League Championship Series.
He was a very young man, 19 years old. Let's go back to the studios in Golden Valley.
Well, I tell you what, sounds like they're locking up behind you guys.
It's pretty much just us. Here come a couple officers back there. Hi, guys.
How you doing, gang?
Thanks for offering us the protection and everything.
They're nice people here.
Yeah, absolutely.
They really are.
The fans have been great here.
I mean, really.
And, I think
they probably think you're pretty strange, but yeah, all right.
Well, they do.
They'll probably tell you to turn off the lights when you leave, huh?
Yeah, it'll be us. We'll probably be the last ones out of here. I think what we're going to try and do is, though, we've been offered two seats, Tommy and I have, on the Twins charter flight home. So hopefully we'll be coming home with the players, and that should be
we'll
quite
be there.
An experience for us. Yeah.
And be down at the dome, right?
Yeah.
Rally, 9
o'clock.
That'll
be fun.
Okay, see you guys then.
Still ahead on News 11, Paul Douglas says we're in for a touch of Indian summer.
And a message from the fans to the Twins for a job well done. That's an understatement. Let's rejoin our Champagne Bureau in Detroit.
Yeah, that's right.
Not up here. This is sort of the hot dog and water barrel right here.
Well, I'll tell you, that's a fact.
Not exactly beautiful surroundings that we're in.
You know, Marv Albert from NBC Sports came up to me last night. We were talking. He said, you know, this Twins team is a great ball club, and they're a nice bunch of guys.
Yeah.
And that's right. He hit the nail right on the head, and I think Jeff's with one of the nice guys.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I am with the nice bunch of guys, and now I got shaving creamed, and now I'm getting iced. And Don Baylor, you've been down this road many times before.
Oh, jeez.
I'm going to keep doing this because people want to hear from you, Don.
You need a horse.
But you've been down. Oh, this road, so I can't even talk.
Let me interview you.
Yeah, go ahead. Just say whatever you want. Do it.
Yeah, this is a great feeling. Minneapolis-St. Paul should be very proud of this ball club because we played with a lot of heart and a lot of intensity when we came here. We were not given a chance to even win a ball game, and we won 4 out of 5 and won 2 out of 3 here to beat them.
Were you surprised at all at this Twins team, the way they've come through? You've been in some championship teams.
Well, we just got on a roll, and all of a sudden, once you get on the roll, you start believing that you can do it. And I think the first ball game that we won was the first night. When you win the first one, you think about winning two. And Detroit was in trouble once they lost two ball games because it's really tough to come back. And they felt like they were coming home, but they were not swinging the bats like they've been swinging them against Toronto.
I think a lot of people are going to give Don Baylor credit because your veteran leadership was also a settling influence in the stretch drive here.
Well, it was a lot of fun to participate in a different capacity. I had to kind of come off the bench and do some things. And all of a sudden, you start working with some guys like Gagne and seeing some interesting things happen. Seeing some interesting things happen to some young players, finally being in a playoff to get the exposure and want to do well, and they came through.
Don Baylor, you and the Twins have made us proud. Nice going.
Thank you.
All right, keep doing it in the series, too. Back upstairs, guys.
He looks like he's something out of one of those monster movies.
A little hot wax, and he'll have the full deal there, won't he?
Paul, I came that close to being down there with him in the locker room. I'm glad I'm up here with you.
Safety in numbers. I needed you up here with me. I'll tell you what, right now, let's head back to the studio to Diana and Kevin.
Thank you, guys. Well, I think it's raining champagne in Detroit and nothing but blue skies here because, of course, the Twins have won. Paul Douglas will have his forecast at 10. So join us then if you want to know what the weather is like. Until then, still to come, News 11, the National League. We'll find out how they're stacking up.
And a salute to the Twins who are definitely on a roll.
Well, we are back again. We're going to go back to Detroit with Tom and Paul.
More importantly, I want to find out how Passel's doing.
Passel, I know we'll have to check up on him in just a bit.
I think he just went down for the second time. I'm not sure.
He'll definitely need a shower before he heads out of here.
He got the worst dunking. But, you know, really, we've all been a pretty good pal of the players, and Jeffy knows him very, very well, and I think it's a form of affection, really.
Oh, absolutely.
He really got it.
In fact, if you want to check on Jeffy, let's go down there right now. Yeah. I think he's down there with Gene Marken.
Jeff.
Right?
Hey, I used to be a pal with the players. You guys did me in, Gene.
Well, they must like you for doing that stuff to you. But, it's a big thrill for all of us, and we're real happy about it. We just got to keep it going for the World Series.
It's got to be a thrill for you, your rookie year, to be on a team that's in the World Series.
Yeah, coming up from AAA this year, it's a big thrill for me. I feel real fortunate, and hopefully I can contribute in the series.
You started out this year in the minor league. Do you ever think you'd end up here?
Hell no. We played a pretty bad AAA team. Big thrill for me, real big thrill.
Well, we're excited about what you did. Okay, Sal Butera says it's time to get on the bus. These guys got to get cleaned up, and I think maybe I do too. Back to you guys.
All right, well, I guess we should talk a little about the National League.
Absolutely. That's what we'll have to sit back and watch now is that battle.
Now, tomorrow, that'll be on Channel 11 and NBC, and it'll be a couple of left-handers who pitch a great deal alike. You have Dave Dravecki of the San Francisco Giants. He throws a lot of dipsy-doodle stuff in out. He reminds you a lot of Frank Tanana. John Tudor really doesn't have that much heat either. He pitches very similarly, and, of course, the Cardinals are down 3-2, but they're going back into their spacious home ballpark in St. Louis, hoping that their speed and defense will bring them back into a tie and eventually a win. And for me, if that would happen, Paul, it would be a lifetime dream. I mean, it would be, you know,
You've been living in Minnesota now for how many years? 17 years?
17 years,
and
yes.
And you grew up in St. Louis.
Grew up in St. Louis.
You told us earlier you wouldn't have any problem rooting for the Twins.
No, without a doubt, because I don't know any of the Cardinals now. Stan Musial's gone. Ina Slaughter is gone. And those little birds and the bats, I still love those in their uniforms.
How about your dad? Your dad's still kicking around. What would he go for?
He would root for the Twins.
What a guy.
I mean, what a guy.
I like your pop.
My mom and dad both. They would go for the Twins. And it would be exciting. So I'm not going to give up. I'm very hopeful that the Cardinals can do it. And my aunts called for tickets and my buddies. And so it'd be kind of neat to go down there.
The Twins wrapped up. They clinched their pennant early and had to continue playing Texas for a while, losing those games, while Detroit and Toronto were embroiled in that tremendous series at the end of the year. And we speculated earlier, what impact does that have on the Twins? They've got everything wrapped up. They're just sort of going through the motions. Detroit and Toronto really going at it. Well, it turns out the Twins come in here and knock them off 4-1. How do you see the Twins now sitting back and having this much time to rest prior to facing somebody in the series?
Well, obviously it didn't hurt them in this series, so that's a very good omen. Sometimes that can hurt you to lose your momentum, but they just came out like they were smoking, and Detroit had been playing and fighting for its life and then wins it on the final day. So apparently the rest, they've already proved the rest will not hurt them, so we hope that'll be the case in the series.
Well, I want to thank you and Jeff and everybody for letting me tag along over here to watch this baseball and work with you. Kind of been fun putting on my sports head.
You're not done yet. We're going to the Dome.
Yeah, that's true.
Going to the Metrodome.
We'll come back to the studio with Diana and Kevin.
Oh, thanks, guys.
Great job.
Your work is not done yet.
Great job.
We'll see you back here in the Twin Cities.
Finally, this evening, as the Twins march toward the World Series, you can bet there'll be plenty of celebrating right here in the Twin Cities.
Including tonight at 9 o'clock at the Metrodome. Now, we're going to leave you now with a photo essay put to Prince's song, Let's Go Crazy. Go, Twins. We'll see you at 10.
Go.
This afternoon, the team did something they haven't done since 1965, and they've won their way to the World Series by beating the Detroit Tigers in a thrilling game. Good evening. The Twins going to the World Series tops this special edition of News 11.
Now, Paul Majors will be joining us shortly for all the excitement of the Twins. First, the celebration besides the one out at the Dome could be heard throughout the Twin Cities tonight. In downtown Minneapolis, fans are celebrating and letting it all ring out. Some have even dressed up their cars for the occasion.
Number one!
And of course, the Homer hanky is a big part of all the celebrations. At Twin Cities International Airport, loyal Twins fans poured off a plane from the site of the big victory, Detroit. Among the fans, Governor Rudy Perpich, who went to Detroit to watch the Twins assure themselves of a place in the World Series.
Now, all the action right now, though, is at the Metrodome.
So let's go to News 11's Steve Carroll, who's with a lot of dedicated fans, Steve.
Unbelievable.
It's simply an unbelievable sight here in the Metrodome. The crowd sensing they're on TV and the whole shebang. A capacity crowd here at the Metrodome for more than 50,000. You can't even hear yourself think, Kevin and Diana. But anyhow, fans have been jammed in here to the Metrodome for close to 2 hours. They've been jumping, they've been cheering, they've been waving their Homer hankies. These guys have been bottled up the excitement for more than 22 years. And they're letting it all hang out tonight here at the Dome. Let's take a listen. Of course, everyone is here waiting for the American League champions to arrive. And I understand they have landed at the airport. And at this time, we go live to News 11's Dennis Stauffer, who is standing by waiting for the American League champion Minnesota Twins. Dennis?
We have a shot for you right now of the plane taxiing towards us with the Twins on board here at the Hubert H. Humphrey International Terminal at Twin Cities International. They should be departing from the plane in just moments. We have a small crowd of people out here, but the crowd was discouraged from coming tonight. Just a few people lining the fence, waiting to greet the Twins as they get back to Minnesota soil, bringing that pennant with them. They'll get off the plane here and be heading for the Dome on some buses which are waiting to pick them up. And here is the plane you can see taxiing in right now. We imagine they've been doing some partying on the way home. And they'll all be boarding, deboarding here in just a moment. I think you can still hear me over the plane. They'll be here for us in just a moment. We're stepping out of the way so they can pull those stairs up to the plane. And in just a moment, folks here in Minnesota will get their first look at the Twins since they defeated Detroit this afternoon in an amazing series that surprised not only some Minnesotans, but indeed the whole country. And then again, perhaps a lot of Minnesotans weren't surprised by what this team has accomplished in the past several days. They certainly had the fans behind them here at home and in many respects even in Detroit. They are about to open the plane now and we'll be greeting the team as it comes off. It certainly has been quite a day and quite a week for the Twins. And they, I can see them standing lined up inside the plane ready to come out at any moment, so we'll wait till they get the door open and we'll get a look at them. We have some security people there. The crowd is waiting at the Metrodome. Thousands of people ready to greet them there. And here we see the team coming off the plane. A few officials. Some wives, it looks like. We have our own Paul Majors and Tom Ryder on the plane somewhere who were invited to come back. There's Calvin Griffith. This is something Minnesotans have waited for 22 years. And here we have some faces you can recognize, some I don't. You probably don't either, but here we have, yeah.
That's Andy McPhail. Dennis is Randy back in the studio.
Coming down now.
That's Sid Hartman there from the Star Tribune.
Sid Hartman.
More Twins coming, Twins dignitaries and family and
we have
friends. John Gordon on the broadcasting
team. All sorts of people that are with
team.
The Twins organization that have been on this plane helping them celebrate, I'm sure. Family and friends and executives. Some media that was invited to come back, including, as I said, Tom and Paul. And here we have the team. We have team members and wives still blowing whistles as they did in Detroit. They upset a lot of people in Detroit, but certainly no one here. Bly Levin just went out of view there.
Tom Bernanski.
Tom Bernanski, the bottom of the stairs.
Look at the dome. That's unbelievable.
All of them wearing
George
their
Frazier.
Minnesota Twins t-shirts.
Mike Smithson.
Just as quickly as they get off the plane, they're getting on buses where they'll head to the dome. We have the team continuing to come off the plane. They're getting on buses. They should be at the dome very shortly, and we'll be able to pick up the celebration there in just a little while. Let's go to Gail Pluwaki now.
Okay, this is incredible. The fans are so excited. I don't know if you can hear me for sure, but we've got all sizes, all ages here. Everyone is having a wonderful time. We have a couple of real small fans here, but there's no lack of enthusiasm just because they're little. This is Anthony. He's just enchanted with watching. He's just enchanted with watching some of his stars climbing off that airplane. He just can't contain himself either. We also have Asha Blake standing outside of the dome. Asha, how's it going out there?
Well, Gail, it's not as loud out here, but these guys are excited, right? They're all standing out here waiting for the Twins to get here. They've left the airport shortly, I understand, and we'll be here waiting for them to get here. We'll be right here when the truck comes in. I tell you, earlier tonight, all the fans that are inside were out here waving their homer hankies, just yelling and screaming. Mothers, fathers, sisters, sisters, brothers. I tell you, we're set when they get here. We'll toss it back to you at the airport, Dennis.
We're still at the airport, and I'm hearing almost nothing over what crowd is here. Here's Tom and Paul coming off the plane now. Paul, step over here just a moment. You guys got to ride on the plane back. It must have been quite a celebration coming back from Detroit.
Yeah, you might say they were a little bit excited, just a little bit. A lot of smiles. It was real interesting for me, obviously. My first trip back with any championship team of sorts in any type of sport. It was very exciting.
Tom, this was the first one you've seen in many years.
Well, it's the first one here, that's for sure. I came back from three Super Bowl trips, although the Vikings played well, but there was no winner. But this was really a great trip back. It was something that we've all waited for. And I'm still almost speechless, which is unusual for me.
Well, you may have more to talk about yet tonight. I think you've been told you're going to be going to the Dome and helping us follow the celebration there. So we'll see you in just a few minutes.
All right. Thanks, Dennis.
All right. We'll go back to the studio.
All right. Dennis, thank you very much. And, of course, we'll be going down to the Metrodome just a little bit later.
Fans, the true fans of the Twins.
Incredible.
Down at the Metrodome.
It's nice to see that type of turnout for our winning Twins. Now, of course, the Stampede is on for World Series tickets. They'll go on sale at all Metro Dayton stores tomorrow morning beginning at 8 a.m. Tickets will sell for $20 and $30 with a limit of 4 per game.
Now, hundreds of Twins fans are already lining up for tickets, prepared to camp out overnight.
And Carolyn Marinan joins us from outside Dayton's. No, we're not going to go to Carolyn right now.
We're not going to go to Carolyn right now. Extra police are on duty right now. That's what we'll do right now. Extra police are on duty in downtown Minneapolis as the Twins attract thousands of you, as you saw, fans, and also a little bit of rowdiness. He's going to report on how authorities are dealing with all this.
It says, stop, read before all!
They were popping champagne bottles in downtown Minneapolis within minutes of the Twins' victory.
Yeah!
Although it's illegal to drink in public, there were Twins fans who did so anyway. And the cheering fans spilled into the streets. The shouts of fans were often answered by the sounds of horns honking from passing motorists. And as the drinking in the streets continued, some officers seemed to just look the other way. As the afternoon revelry continued into the evening hours, the crowds grew louder and bigger. Extra police were called in to keep watch on the partygoers. Some fans were still drinking openly, but as one officer said, you'd have to be crazy to go into a crowd this big and make an arrest for an open bottle.
With the officers brought in from the various precincts and the reservists called in tonight, police estimate they've got an extra 50 officers working the streets around the Dome.
We've got an exuberant crowd, but we expect that as a happy group. We don't expect any problems, but as you can see, we're turning out the troops to make sure that it's well covered.
Exuberant is right, and while no one needed searchlights to find the Dome, the lights were all part of the show, and the fans, they loved it. In Minneapolis, Bernie Grace, News 11.
Now, so far, there have been no arrests at the Dome, but after the party at the Dome is over, there may be a few.
One thing that's gotten out of control with pennant fever are the requests for Homer hankies. Yes, reports are the requests are coming in from all around the country. The first order was for 200,000 hankies. Now, that's gone, and more are on the way.
And coming up, more coverage of the Twins tonight.
We'll be right back.
All right, as we mentioned earlier, hundreds of Twins fans are already lining up for tickets, prepared to camp out overnight.
Carolyn Marinan joins us from outside the Dayton store at Rosedale. Carolyn.
Hello, Kevin and Diana. We found just a few fans here at Rosedale, and they are excited, and they're also waiting for tickets. They go on sale tomorrow morning here at Dayton's and other Metro stores in Rochester at 9:30. Now, they'll be camping out here until they go on sale. You might expect this is a little bit of a mob, but not really. They've got getting tickets down to a system.
So how do hundreds of hysterically happy Twins fans who all want World Series tickets get them?
If you're 725 or over, form a line between these two cars and move down that way.
Well, at the Dayton's in the Rosedale parking lot, they were trying to do it with a little order. Since fans weren't allowed to line up until closing time tonight, security guards gave fans a helpful hint on avoiding a mob scene.
795.
Fans lined up for a number and then reported to fellow fan Linda Simmons, who volunteered her services.
In the order that they came, they get a chance to buy the tickets in the order that they came, so that the person that came at 11:30 gets to buy tickets first.
The lucky ones who got here early were all smiles.
We're 25, 26, and 27 in line, so we're going to get our tickets, and we're going to be there with their little home hankies.
I'm number 26, and I will have my four tickets, and I will be there, and we're going to take it in five.
Kevin and Diana, there are just a few here who share that enthusiasm. At least 800, more than 800, have had the numbers. I think if the Twins were to come back Saturday, a few people are ready to cheer them on. The Twins going to do it? They're going to do it? Back to you, Kevin and Diana.
All right. Thanks, Carolyn.
Thanks, Carolyn.
Well, it's been 22 years since the Twins have savored a World Series berth. The year was 1965. The Twins faced the Los Angeles Dodgers in a championship series that went the full seven games. The Twins lost the finale at the old Met Stadium on this Sandy Koufax strikeout of Bob Allison, and the Dodgers went on to reign as the 65 World Series champs.
But the game that is rewriting the history books for the Twins is the one that set the Twin Cities on fire today.
We have a series of team reports tonight from the Tiger Stadium, where the Twins assured themselves a place in World Series history, and we begin with Tom Reither.
In the second inning with no score, the Twins coming up with four big runs. Tom Bradansky, a two-run double off Doyle Alexander. It was 2-0. Dan Gladden later a base hit, and Lombard Dozy scored. That made it 3-0. Then it was Kirby Puckett, another base hit, and Gladden comes in to score 4-0. In the fourth inning, Twins leading 4-1. Detroit's Matt Noakes, a two-run homer to right off Blylevin, and the lead was cut to 4-3. In the eighth inning, Dan Gladden had doubled earlier, but a miscue by Lou Whitaker allowed Gladden to score. It was 6-3. Also in the eighth inning, Chet Lemon of Detroit, a solo opposite field home run to right off Juan Berenguer, and it was 6-4 Minnesota. In the ninth inning, Tom Bradansky, who's had a great series, named the game MVP, a solo home run off Mike Hinneman, and the Twins led 7-4. Two more runs made it 9-4. Now the final out. Jeff Reardon to Matt Noakes, Twins leading 9-5, a comebacker to Reardon over to first base, and a 22-year wait is over. The Twins are headed to the World Series. Jeff Passolt was in the locker room for the victory celebration.
The end of today's game brought on a euphoric state. The players embracing one another, knowing they had really pulled off a major accomplishment. And in the locker room, a celebration the likes of which Minnesota had not seen in 22 years. A well-deserved celebration when your team hadn't been in a World Series in that long a time. Gary Gaetti, the series MVP, was quick to point out that it took a total team effort.
I've never seen a team. I've never played against a team with as much drive and determination and enthusiasm as this team showed in this series.
Oh, it feels great, Jeff. It's a fantastic feeling. You can't really explain it. What I'm really happy for are the people back home. Finally waiting, and we finally made it, and hopefully we can keep on going.
I can't believe I made it, man. A couple years ago, I was in the minor leagues, and this is my lifelong dream to make it to the World Series, and I'm going now, man. I'm enjoying myself.
I am with the nice bunch of guys, and now I got shaving creamed, and now I'm getting iced. And Don Baylor, you've been down this road many times before.
Oh, shit!
I'm going to keep doing this because people want to hear from you, Don.
You need a horse?
But you've been down. Oh!
Quite obviously, it was also a celebration that involved more than the players. In Detroit, Jeff Passolt, News 11.
Now, security in Detroit was tight.
And our team report from Tiger Stadium continues with News 11's Melissa Young.
Detroit's men in blue were out in force, making sure win or lose, there were no problems. Fans entering the grandstand were checked over carefully.
To make sure they have no booze or guns or knives or anything, no weapons.
In the bleacher seats, they took even more precautions. But many fans didn't take kindly to the friskings.
That's nothing but an indictment on the city of Detroit when the common fan has to come in and be frisked to go to a damn ball game. That's ridiculous.
So when the final out was made, there was pandemonium on the field and even some off. But police report no major problems.
We're number one! We're number one!
It may have come to Detroit, but the Twins fans weren't disappointed.
That's the best thing that ever happened.
This is wonderful. Our Twins are red hot.
And I was out in Vegas in March. I bet 30-1 on the Twins to win the pennant at 10 bucks. I've been supporting them with my heart.
And how much are you going to make?
$300.
Twins fans say except for a few dirty looks in the stands, Detroit was a very hospitable town, especially on the playing field. Melissa Young, News 11, Detroit.
Speaking of Twins fans, let's go back to the Dome where think about 50,000 Twins
least,
fans.
At least, 50,000 excited fans waiting for the Twins to show up. Steve Carroll.
Well, Diane and Kevin, this place is going bananas. You can sense the excitement is building here. I'd say the Twins will be here within the next 5 or 10 minutes, and these fans can hardly wait. As you see behind them, they're involved in some cheers. Some of them are waving their homer hankies. They are waiting to explode after 22 years since the last appearance in the World Series. I wouldn't be surprised if they blow the roof right off the Dumpty Dome. We'll have to stand by and see what happens, and we'll have the latest as a team shows up to the Dome a little bit later. But for now, Kevin and Diana, back to you.
He's gone through a few cheers. Not bad.
That is an incredible scene.
Yeah, thanks, Steve.
So later tonight on News 11, we'll see how Twins fans spent this unforgettable day.
And we'll profile one Twins fan who hopes some of the team's magic rubs off on him.
Head for the World Series, and right about now, the Metrodome. One thing is for certain, they couldn't have done it without the support of the fans. For instance, in Bloomington, workers at Layman's Body Shop got a break from the boss, who allowed them all to stop work and cheer the team on television. In Minnetonka, shoppers stood deadlocked in TV departments as the sets were tuned to the game. Anxious fans stood by watching when they could. In Minneapolis, some seniors got in on all the action, complete with their homer hankies. They watched the game at the Metro Career Center, waving their hankies.
Another Twins fan, 9-year-old Chris Sicente, watched today's game from his hospital room. The New Jersey boy came to Minnesota for a bone marrow transplant. Medical reporter Susan Wiese tells us the boy hopes the Twins' magic will rub off on him.
Hi, Bert.
Chris Sicente is watching the windup and pitch of his favorite Minnesota twin, Bert Blyleven.
I think he pitches really well.
He's the same ball player who earlier this summer took time to give this little leaguer some pointers.
Okay, one more time.
It was Blyleven who invited Sicente to the Twins' dugout back in June. That's when the Twins still had a grueling season ahead of them, and Chris, an operation that possibly would rid his body of leukemia.
Nearly 4 months after undergoing a bone marrow transplant here at University Hospital, Chris Sicente's body still is not producing enough healthy blood cells.
Like the Twins, Chris has been taking things one day at a time, and while he's waiting to bounce back, Chris is watching the Twins clinch the pennant and already is hoping they'll get themselves a comfortable lead once the World Series gets underway.
A comfortable lead is 156-0.
His message for Blyleven and the rest of the team?
Don't mess it up.
It seems this 9-year-old knows what it takes to win.
It's mostly what it's about. You gotta keep on trying and do your best.
It's advice from a young fan who hopes to triumph in his own struggle to survive. Susan Wiese, News 11 at University Hospital.
And they didn't mess it up, Chris. Chris's dad cooked up a special meal for him. He dined on veal cutlet on this special day.
And it's time to go back to the Metrodome for an update on that huge rally.
News 11's Asha Blake is there with more. Asha.
Hi there, Di. I tell you what, we are standing right outside Gate D. We're standing right pulling up shortly. It's going to be coming in right down here. I've got a ton of fans out here, and we will yell for the team when they get here. They should be here in about 10 minutes. That's what we understand. We'll be here ready and waiting. Back to you, Diane, Kevin.
Okay. Thank you. I guess that's 10 long minutes at this point.
Be careful out there. Still ahead tonight on News 11, more on this important day for the Minnesota Twins.
Also tonight, controversy over taverns in Wisconsin and a plan to extend drinking hours.
We'll visit a family who's had to deal with telling their kids about an incurable disease.
And we'll get the latest on a tropical storm sweeping the southeast from Paul Douglas when we return.
Kevin and Diana, yes, I might mention I did see Wally the beer man working the aisles. He's a busy man tonight. This crowd here can hardly wait. Every single one of them, now over 55,000. The place is packed, ladies and gentlemen. They're all on their feet waiting and chanting for the American League champions. Minnesota Twins are on the way. Should be here at the Metrodome in the next couple of minutes. We'll go up to Gail Pawacki right now, who's standing by with some very anxious Twins fans. Gail?
The enthusiasm here is incredible. You can see behind me, these people are just waiting for their superheroes to get here tonight. And their enthusiasm isn't dying down at all with the wait. But right now we have Asha Blake waiting outside. And Asha, can you tell us what's going on out there? I tell you what, we are out here. Wally the beer man isn't out here, but these guys are having a good time anyway. We're still standing by the gate, still waiting for the bus. It's going to be here in a few minutes. Steve, back to you.
All right, Ashley, I'm not exactly sure what you said, but the crowd in here is going absolutely bananas. They sense the Minnesota Twins are just moments away from arriving here at the Metrodome, and indeed they are. We have just heard that the Twins are within, three or four minutes of arriving here. Of course, they'll deboard the plane, or deboard the bus, and then make their way single file, one by one, I'm sure waving to all the fans that have showed up here at the Metrodome to salute the team that's given them so much to cheer about tonight. And now let's go up to Gail in the stands with more Twins fans. Gail?
Okay. Look at here. Let's get up here with a fan and see just how they're feeling about their Twins arriving.
How do you feel about the Twins being here? Yeah.
Oh, we're so glad to have them back. They're number one.
Number one.
They're going to make it all the way.
Number one.
Four in a row. Four in a row.
Number one. We're number one. Take the Giants.
Take the Giants.
Giants and the Twins.
Double one way, double one.
Okay, my understanding is that the Twins have arrived. We're going to go to Asha Blake outside the dome now and see what's happening. Asha?
Gail, the bus is coming. They have a police escort. You'll be able to see them in just a minute. You fans inside the dome, it's just a couple more minutes. Here comes the police escort right now. There are two police cars, or three, I believe, and the bus is coming just right around the corner. You'll be able to see it in just a minute. You can see the players. They're waving to the fans that are out here. The fans are here. They're going absolutely crazy, and with good reason. There are a couple hundred fans out here right now. You people in the dome, just a few more minutes. You can hear the crazy fans out here. They can't wait for the team to get here. And the team is really excited. You can see from where we are, they are just waving and they're all smiles. There are tears in their eyes. We can even see that from here, and we're quite a ways away. Okay, you can see the fans crowding the bus right now. Can't wait for the team to get off. They're just in front of the doorway, and they should be walking out shortly. They're going to be coming right underneath us, so they'll be coming into just a few more minutes. Okay, you can see the team right now. You can hear the fans outside the dome. They'll be in the dome in just a few more minutes. Okay, here they come right now. The team is coming right into the dome. They're waving to all the fans out here, and the fans are waving back. They're real excited. There goes your champions. And there's another bus coming down, too. You'll be able to see that in just a few minutes. And the fans are following the first bus and staying with the second bus. And they can't believe they're finally home. They've been waiting for this for hours. Fans have been out here since 5 o'clock. And I'll tell you, it's a little bit nippy out here, too. So these are diehard fans. They can't wait for them to get here. They're waiting for them to get inside the dome. They're number one. You can hear it yourself. I don't have to tell you that. Number one. The Twins are number one. Some fans are getting in the way. They're stopping the second bus from getting through. And they're just getting off the bus and walking in. They're not even waiting for the bus to pull into the dome. They want to talk to the fans in person.
Number one! Number one!
They'll be inside the dome in just a minute.
Number one!
The Twins, players, executives, wives, waving home their hankies. You can tell they're glad to be home and glad to be back with their fans who've supported them for so long.
climbing out of the bus. Can't wait to get inside the dome. We're number one. The fans out here are absolutely going crazy. Okay, Steve, time to take it to you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the moment people have been waiting for 22 years. The American League champion Minnesota Twins are about to arrive at their home, the Hubert H. Humphrey Metrodome. As you see, they're coming down the tunnel in the right field bullpen. They're gathering right behind. I think they're probably having a team meeting right about now. But they should be walking out of the turf here at the dome in a matter of moments. The crowd is on their feet waving their homer hankies and standing and cheering. As I said, they've waited for this moment for some 22 years. 1965 is the last year that the Twins made it to the World Series. Of course, they lost in seven games to the Los Angeles Dodgers. But hopefully, this year will be an entirely different story. The Twins have the momentum going into postseason play. The crowd has quieted now as they wait for the American League champion Twins to arrive. They're now gathering. They are gathered in behind one of the doorways here at the Metrodome, waiting for them to come. The scoreboard has pronounced the Twins, of course, the 1987 American League champions, and the crowd is just can hardly wait for their heroes to arrive. They've already got off the bus and are just kind of gathering their thoughts and perhaps some of their emotion behind closed doors before they walk out into this arena that will no doubt overwhelm each and every one of those players. For sure, no doubt, the biggest highlight of all their careers. The players will be coming in from the right field bullpen, the door there that's right under the home of the Twins, the American League Western Division champions, here at the Metrodome in Minneapolis, Minnesota. That's where they'll be coming in. As I said, they're probably gathering their thoughts and emotions right about now before they make their grand entrance. And I'll tell you what, this capacity crowd here at the Dome can hardly wait for their heroes to come in. The roof is about to go out of the Metrodome. The homer hankies are flying. The crowd is going nuts. They waited for this moment since 1965. I gotta believe the players are within seconds of coming out. The players may, or the fans may have gotten an inside scoop about what's going on, because they're going bananas. They probably have a better view of what's happening down there at the Metrodome, down there at the closed door. The band and the organ is starting to pick up. You can sense they're about to come out. Now let's go up to Gail Pawacki. Maybe she's got a better view of the whole situation. Gail?
This is incredible. These people are, they can hardly contain themselves. You can see they can't wait for their heroes. The door is opening. The door is opening. Here come their heroes. They just can hardly wait to see their superheroes. They're all watching the door open. It's incredible. It's just incredible. It's just incredible. These people, the noise in here, we can't hear ourselves. Like, it's just incredible. The door is opening. Okay. These people, this the moment has arrived. They've been waiting for this. These are their Twins. They've waited years for this championship. These people are so, this is a very special night for all of them. They're watching the door open. The band is on the field playing. These people are just absolute.
Champions. Is that a fitting welcome?
That is a fitting welcome. We just got off the plane, I'd say, 20 minutes ago, and if we look a little perspiring, we could have a hard time getting into the press box here, but We have a packed crowd at the Metrodome.
Let's just sit and enjoy some of the pictures here.
That's
obviously
it.
Right now you're looking at some of the Twins' wives. It's easy to tell who they are. They are the ones with the whistles.
The ones who were in Detroit cheering on their husbands, the Minnesota Twins, the 1987 American League champions.
And of course, on the way back, Paul, we heard those whistles on the plane close up.
Yeah, when we touched down as the plane landed, they started blowing their whistles out of joy. The Twins are quite happy to be home, obviously. The crowd is happy to have them here. Carl Pohlad right there.
Wife Eloise. There you see the group coming in now. The plane landed only about 20, 25 minutes ago. There's Frankie Viola. He pitched yesterday. Tom Bernanski way in the back. That big guy waving handkerchief, that was Don Baylor. There's Frankie Viola. There you see Roy Smalley.
We'll just sit back and let the players enjoy this.
They can hardly contain themselves. They'd like to let everybody know how they feel about their Twins.
How do they feel about
them? Yeah. We're number one!
We're number one!
Hi, Ma!
We are number one!
This is a welcome like no other. This is just incredible.
Tell you, let's share it one more time for the American League champion, Minnesota Twins. Now, folks, we don't know whether our Twins are going to be playing St. Louis or San Francisco in the World Series. But I'll tell you, wait a minute, I'll tell you, if anybody thinks that the St. Louis club is going to beat the Minnesota Twins, they're making a cardinal sin. And
if anybody thinks San Francisco is going to beat the Twins, they're making a giant mistake. Let's have a hand for the owner of the Minnesota Twins, Carl Pohlad, right here. Twins president Jerry Bell. Where's Jerry? Welcome, Jerry.
Thank you, Herb. I just can't believe this, and I just cannot thank these fans enough. Obviously, and certainly everybody here knows, we couldn't have done this without the fans. No question about it. We're the best fans in town.
Thank you, Jerry. Well, as you folks know, if you followed us over the season, the Twins, we've had some rough spots. And there are times when we've had some doubting Thomases. People are ready to write them off. But I tell you, this team has risen to the occasion. They've done the job when they've had to do it, haven't they? Inexperienced Minnesota Twins. They didn't know anything about playoffs. Couldn't win on the road, could they? Well, I tell you, we have a gentleman who I think has done a great job as far as keeping things on an even keel when the boat was rocking a little bit. Our skipper, Tommy Kelly. TK.
I heard. What's happening? How do these things happen?
Somebody got the schedule mixed up. We should have played here today.
It's been sort of nice. No, the guys, I speak on behalf of all the guys. This is unbelievable turnout. This is magnificent for the Upper Midwest, Minneapolis, St. Paul. I wish we had room on our World Series roster for another person, and I think I would try to include all the people here today on our 24-man roster, but we just can't do that. But it's great.
How long is it going to take to beat the National League?
Well, we're going to do the best we can. Put me in a bad spot there.
We'll do it in six. How about that? Six games. Thank you, Tommy. Now, folks, we want you to meet the members of this ball club. And I think I'm especially happy for our coaching staff because they're somewhat the unsung heroes. The ball players, of course, don't think so, but I know from the news media standpoint, you don't hear a lot about our coaching, but I think that these guys are the hardest working people on the ball club. First of all, right here is our pitching coach and Mr. and Mrs. Dick Sutch. And one of the greatest all-time Twins, hitting coach Tony Oliva. And and our catching and bullpen coach, Rick Stelmasek. First base coach, Wayne Terwilliger. And another former Twin and one of the best third base coaches in the major leagues, Rick Renick. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we know you want to meet the members of our playing roster, the champion Twins. And for the introductions of our players, it's my pleasure to introduce you to my broadcasting partners all year long, John Gordon, John Mooney, and Hall of Famer Harmon Killebrew. John Rooney, right here.
All right, thank you, Herb. I got a message for the fans of Minnesota standing around the batting cage and talking with the Tigers. They couldn't wait to get out of the Metrodome because of all the noise. Way to go, Minnesota fans! Way to go! Meet the American League champion, Minnesota Twins. First off, relief pitcher number 22, Keith Atherton. A guy who's always been a winner everywhere he's been, coming to the Twins before September 1st, number 18, Don Baylor. Fellow they call Senior Smoke El Gasolino, number 40, Juan Berenguer. This man promised a World Series to Minnesota fans. The winning pitcher today, number 28, Bart Blylevin. Series for Bruno, number 24, Tom Brunetsky. This guy was the best pinch hitter in the American League last year, and is an everyday player, an outfielder, a designated hitter. Help the Twins on their way, number 25, Randy Bush. Here's one of the hardest workers on the ball club, a guy who came back for his second time around, number 33, catcher Sal Butera. Now, if you talk to this fella, he'll tell you that he's worked all his life to get right here tonight. They call him Country. Number 27, Mark Davidson. Now, if you will, welcome relief pitcher, number 21,
George Frazier. Hey, Twins fans, way back, touch them all, Twins fans. All right. Slickest fielding shortstop in the major leagues, Greg Gagne. Mr. Glad Ranch, Dan Gladden. Minnesota's own Kent Herbeck.
Thank you so much. I thought 1965 was great, but this is the ultimate. You are so wonderful. Thank you. Let me introduce introduce some players to you. Chris Patero. Chris. Kirby Puckett. Gentlemen, Jeff Reardon. Dan Schatzeter. Of the Minnesota Twins, Herb Cardeal.
Thank you, Harmon. Ladies and gentlemen, one other gentleman who had such a key role in the Twins' success this year because he helped to engineer the trades that brought people like Jeff Reardon, Dan Gladden, Al Newman, Don Baylor over to the Minnesota Ball Club. The executive vice president of our Minnesota Twins, Andy McPhail. Andy?
Thank you. There's been a lot of speculation. There's been a lot of speculation in baseball as to why the Minnesota Twins enjoyed the best home record of all the major leagues. And I think the nation as a whole watching NBC got a good idea why it is. There are 2,081,000 reasons, and we thank you.
Another thing, we need to introduce the people behind the Minnesota Twins, the Twins' wives. How about a hand for them, huh? And right now, the Twins want to say thank you by making a tour of the Metrodome. The American League champion Minnesota Twins.
The walk of champions here for the Twins, eh?
I've never seen anything like it, Paul. Really, the plane ride coming back, people have asked us, was rather subdued. It was pleasant. Everybody had smiles. You heard a few whistles, and I think they were saving up for all of this. And but, you know, there are certain teams at certain times are teams of destiny. I know that's maybe a worn-out cliche, but I think that that may have been the case about this team that was building, sort of like a volcano that really started 2 or 3 months ago when we saw they were still in the pennant race. They were still there. They were still on top. They suffered some misfortunes on the road, still hung in there. And as Herb Brooks told his hockey team in 1980 when they played the Russians, there are certain times in your life that you're supposed to be at a certain place at a certain time to do something very special. I think this is what's happening with this group.
It is amazing. When we were on board the plane, the pilot came on to tell the players that the stadium here was half full, that there were about 25,000 people. And they were, quite frankly, excited at the prospect of seeing 25,000 people. I don't think they expected anything that, like what they're seeing now.
The word had it. Did you hear? The Metrodome is half full. And then, did you hear? It's three quarters full. And when we got here, it was full.
Truly an amazing thing for the Twins. Some of your thoughts about the series against Detroit.
I think when they open up here at the Metrodome, I believe that this area became a baseball area against Kansas City when they clinched a tie for the pennant. On that standing ovation, when the team took the field and went out and won it 8-1. I've been watching baseball around here for 16, 17 years. The area became really a baseball area that day. And it carried through, Paul. It carried through to the first two games against Detroit. Detroit was swept off its feet by the crowd, by the team, knocked off balance. The Twins, playing great defense with clutch hitting, went into Detroit. They had to win one game to come back here and have a chance to win it. They went in and won 2 out of 3. So the series against Detroit, they proved to the world that they belong, despite all the media baloney on the East and West Coast, that they have a terrible road record. And if they were in the East, why, they wouldn't be anywhere. They went out and they beat the best team in the East. And I think maybe the best team in baseball in the Detroit Tigers. And as far as the World Series go, I think they can win that puppy too.
Well, the Twins are just about to complete their victory lap around the dome here in front of a packed house here at the dome. Let's just take a little bit longer look at this and savor the moment.
Right now, from the executive committee of the Minnesota Twins, how about a hand for Howard Fox? The great thing about baseball, the tradition, and the way you can look back, and the way you hold things, all you have to do is look back 1 year to what Bert Blyleven had to say on Fan Appreciation Day just 1 year ago. Let's look back 1 year.
Of course, has their attention turned towards the scoreboard here at the Dome, the reader board, and it's a soundbite for Bert Blyleven talking 1 year ago on Fan Appreciation Day, telling him people here how much he appreciates their effort, and he wanted to bring a World Series back, and that's what they just heard. He apparently can see into the future, huh?
Rather prophetic, and coming from Bert, who went out and won the big game today, and he was very emotional. I remember that last year, and he said, we want to bring you a World Series. Well, it starts here next Saturday.
Take a look back down on the field once again.
I really don't think I can talk on behalf of all the players, but this is outstanding. We're number one.
If I can get your attention, we forgot to mention a couple people. Our home clubhouse man, Jim Wiesner, is somewhere around here. Jim Wiesner. Our head trainer, Dick Martin. His assistant, Brad. Brad, where are you at? There he is. And I'll tell you what. The best traveling secretary in baseball, Laurel Preeb. You know, last year on Fan Appreciation Day, I did feel that this organization had something to offer. And I really feel that with the 24 guys, we had a goal out of spring training to win our division. And we were the underdogs going into Detroit. But we showed them, didn't we? Now going into the World Series, 24 guys here, along with Tom Kelly and the coaches and the front office that want to do one thing. We want a World Series champ here in Minnesota, and we need your support. John? Just to close, again, on behalf of all the players, this is something we will never forget. Thank you for coming out. Thank you.
I don't know, Tommy. One would have to suspect the adrenaline from a night like this is going to carry them right into the World Series.
You know, I've seen a lot of events like this, but none with the intensity or the feeling and emotion. This area no longer can be branded as the area of losers. This team went out and just wiped that away today by winning the American League Championship. And Blylevin, I mean, this is a guy, there's an old saying in sports, if you can do it, it ain't bragging. And they went out and did it.
The fans here in Minnesota, if you can use Detroit as the test group for the country, the fans in Minnesota truly have made a huge impression then on the fans across the country. People in Detroit saying to us, your fans really helped your team. Many people there felt the fans were the difference in this series.
They tried to compete with our fans at Detroit, and the only time they had a chance to do it is when Sheridan hit that home run to give them the win 7-6. But even when they tried to keep up with our fans, they were a long way from doing it, but I got to give them credit for trying.
The shirts, by the way, that the Twins are wearing along with those hats tonight, you heard Bert Blylevin introduce Jim Wiesner. Jim is the clubhouse manager in there. Jim had those made. He's the fellow that had them made at the end when they clinched the Western Division crown against Texas. And he also said he had some ready for the American League champions. And on the airplane tonight, he brought them out, and they were all happy to put him on.
And he did. Jimmy's been around a long time. He was the visiting clubhouse guy for years, and now he's with the Twins. And he's as much a part of that team as anybody on the field.
Absolutely. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back with some final thoughts.
Champions, my friend.
Welcome back, everyone, to the Metrodome. Paul Majors again with Tom Reither. And we want to go down to the field right now. Steve Carroll is down there with a special guest, Kent Herbeck. And, Steve, the first question I want you to ask Kent, or I want you to tell him something. Tell him I went ahead and ate my cake with my dinner tonight on board the plane. He wanted my cake.
Okay, I'll tell him that. First of all, Kent, Paul Majors says he ate your cake on the plane.
I'm glad, because we ate our cake in Detroit today. We got all finished in there, and unbelievable reception back here. It's the greatest thing I've ever seen.
Jeannie Herbeck, your thoughts on what's going on tonight?
I just can't believe all these people. It's unbelievable. There's just no words for it. There's 60,000 people here. They had to turn people away, I was told. We were thinking we would be lucky if there were 15,000 people here.
Has it sunk in yet, Ketch? You guys are the American League champions?
It almost feels like we won the World Series, really, the way the people are acting. I don't know what the heck they're going to do for an encore if we end up winning the World Series, but that's our next step, and that's what we want to do. And they might have to take the roof off this place to fit everybody in there. I don't know, but we're going to have some fun.
A little partying tonight?
No, we're going to go up and upstairs and relax and talk about it and probably let it sink in and then worry about what happens tomorrow. And then the next Saturday, we got a ball game.
Steve? All right, Kent and Jeannie, congratulations. Thanks for stopping
Steve.
By.
Thanks, Steve.
Yes, Tom Ryther with a question.
Yeah, Steve, could you ask Kent a question? I know that I might be putting him on the spot, but it's either going to be the St. Louis Cardinals with their speed or the Giants with their power. What does he think about that, or does he want to take a chance?
Kent, Tom Ryther wants to know, do you care who you play, St. Louis or San Francisco?
Tom, really, I don't think anybody's really worrying about who we got to play. We didn't worry if we played Detroit or Toronto. We got Detroit. We played good baseball against them. If we get St. Louis, we'll play good baseball. If we get San Francisco, we play good baseball. The guys don't really care. I like to play St. Louis myself just to cut down the travel a little bit, but I don't really give a heck who we play.
How about that, Tom?
He's the greatest. They're all the greatest. Thank you.
I'll tell you what, it's been a real pleasure for everyone at Channel 11 to bring you the American League Championship Series, our pregame shows as well. We've enjoyed it, and we obviously wish the Minnesota Twins good luck in the World Series. So, Diana and Kevin, we'll come back to you at this point.
All right.
Definitely.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. We'll see you a little bit later. Right now, we're going to go to a commercial break, and then we'll continue. Coming up, because we're going to be showing a special 20-minute presentation on the Twins, and that'll be coming up after Paul Douglas's weather, which I know some folks have been staying up to watch. Specially produced News 11 documentary on the Twins.
So we'll give you a couple of seconds. The documentary, it's filled with hits, runs, no errors, and it's what the folks out at the Metrodome have been watching all night.
Thank you for joining us. Now it's on to the World Series, and all it's left to say is
go
Twins.
Twins.
Good night.
Yeah.
The Twins set the tone for their division championship season over 7 months ago in spring training. In this, their first game of the Grapefruit League season, they came from behind in the bottom of the ninth to beat Cincinnati. Later, Twins home run balls would break car windshields, evidence of the team's long ball prowess.
Uh-oh. And Pocket sends it deep. Way back. Goodbye.
The Twins opened the 87 season at the Dome, sweeping Oakland three straight. Kirby Puckett leading the way with another great catch. The Twins' domination of teams would be the key to success.
Oh, man, nobody's going to get that one. And it's out of here, a two-run homer.
High and deep to left field. Pascal goes back, looks up, put it on the board.
Puckett is the batter, and he hits it deep into center field. Way back!
The Twins clobbered home runs with regularity inside the Metrodome, but outside, their hosts would do most of the clobbering. Corey Snyder hit three home runs for Cleveland in one game against the Twins in May, as the team sank to fifth in the American League West. But back they came in June, led by newly acquired pitcher Joe Niekro. They swept Kansas City in three games at the Dome and moved back into first place. At All-Star time in July, only Kirby Puckett was named to the American League squad, a bitter disappointment for a team in front. In August, at Milwaukee, it was Puckett's bat that brought the Twins back to life.
Catch them all, Kirby Puckett.
He went 6-for-6 with 2 home runs. It was Kirby's bat on September 3rd that made most Twins fans believers. This 459-foot home run to left field against Boston in the bottom of the ninth with 2 outs brought the Twins back, and they won the game in extra innings. During that series, veteran Don Baylor joined the team. Just over 2 weeks ago, the Twins won 6 straight games at home in their final dome stand, but then lost 2 straight to second-place Kansas City.
Deep to left center field. This one is gone. A 3-run home run for Danny Tartable.
That set up a showdown on Sunday, September 27th. It was a day the Twins and Twins fans will never forget.
Over the bucket, drives it to center. Wilson going back. It's deep. It's deep. It's gone. Gaetti drives one to deep center. And this one is gone. Way back and gone.
The Twins won convincingly 8-1. And clinched a tie for the division championship on their final regular season game at home. Now they had to win it on the road. And it happened the next night in Texas. Steve Lombardozzi's single in the eighth made it 4-3 Twins. They go on to win it 5-3. Lombo with 4 RBIs on the night. Jeff Reardon ended the game, and the Twins became the best in the West.
Kelly's 18 years began as a player, a decade in the minor leagues, with one brief stint as a Twin in 1975. Then, after a 5-year minor league managerial career, Kelly joined the Twins as a coach. And then came Kelly's big break, late last season, a chance to manage in the big leagues. And here's proof he isn't always so low-key. Now, after such quick success, Kelly refuses to take all the credit, especially when he hears his name being mentioned as the likely choice for manager of the year.
We're just worrying about winning ball games. I don't really pay too much attention to that. Oh, yeah!
Stadium in Bloomington was the scene of the first 2 games of the 1965 World Series between the Twins and Los Angeles Dodgers. Minnesota started fast in Game 1. Zorlo Versailles cracked a 3-run homer to spark the Twins to an easy 8-2 win. In Game 2, Bob Allison's dramatic catch was the key as the Twins won their second straight from the Dodgers. And for Allison, it was a catch he will never forget.
And I really didn't know if I had the ball in my glove, not because it was in the web. I felt it hit my glove. But when I got through and was able to see the ball in my glove, at the same time, the crowd realizing that, I suppose that they knew I had it too. It was the tremendous roar from the crowd. That was really something to remember.
Another thing Allison remembers is how the Twins saw their 2-0 lead disappear at Dodger Stadium. L.A. captured 3 straight from Minnesota to send the series back to the Twin Cities, with the Dodgers leading 3-2.
The Dodgers win 4-0.
The Twins bounce back in Game 6, though, and again they called on Allison.
And there it goes, into the left field stand.
This time, his two-run homer helped lead the Twins over the Dodgers to even the series at three games apiece.
We still liked our chances, especially after we were able to win the sixth game. We're back on our home ground, and of course, we felt that we'd be able to handle it, even though they had the great Sandy Koufax pitching that seventh game.
But in that seventh game, the great Koufax was just too much for the Twins. He fired a three-hitter, fanning Allison to end the game, and in the process, spoil Minnesota's dreams of a world championship.
The Dodgers are the new world champion.
The 87 Twins are hoping history does not repeat itself.
First time in the Metrodome where I had to come in and take some aspirin after the game because my ears were ringing, being so loud. It was great.
Delirium at the Dome, a nail-biter ends with a Minnesota Twins victory.
Frank Viola pitched ahead of the Tiger hitters early, striking out five in the first three innings, including Bill Matlock twice. Dan Gladden's single in the fifth capped a three-run inning that propelled the Twins to a 4-1 lead. But Viola got behind the hitters in the later innings. This walk to Kirk Gibson led to trouble in the eighth. Alan Trammell's double sent Viola to the showers, and his replacement Jeff Reardon did the job getting two outs, but both by sacrifice fly. The Twins trailed 5-4, basically because Viola got in trouble with his pitch placement. But then trouble for Doyle Alexander, the Tiger starter. He gave up this Kirby Puckett double in the bottom of the eighth to tie the score. Dan Gladden scoring all the way from first base. Then reliever Mike Henneman got behind the hitters and walked Gary Gaetti unintentionally. He left. Willie Hernandez came in, and Don Baylor, the veteran from Boston with the bases loaded, did the job.
That's a hit. One run is home. They'll stop Herbeck at third.
It turned out to be the game winner as the Twins won 8-5 to take the lead in the series 1-0.
I guess if you say so, I'll have to pack my things and go.
That's right, hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more.
What you say?
Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more.
Baby, don't you treat me this away, cause I'll be back on my feet someday.
No care if you do, cause it's understood. You ain't got no money, you just ain't no good.
Well, I guess if you say so, I'll have to pack my things and go.
That's right, hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more.
What you say?
Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back. Don't you come back? No.